Welcome back to this next video, and this is the part 4 on the neuronal signaling. And in this particular video, I want to focus on the release of the neurotransmitters from the presynaptic neuron into the synaptic cleft, where they can actually interact with the receptors on the postsynaptic neuron to generate response, a cellular response. Now, when you talk about the release of the neurotransmitter, you are actually talking about two neurons. The first one that is known is the presynaptic neuron. And when you talk about the presynaptic neuron, there are neurotransmitter vesicles. And within the neurotransmitter vesicles, you have got these neurotransmitters. So this is what you are having at the end of the presynaptic neuron, which are known as the axon terminal, or you can call them as the presynaptic terminals. The other one that is known is the postsynaptic neuron, and on the surface of the postsynaptic neuron, you have got these receptors. So what happens is, when the presynaptic neuron, they release their neurotransmitter into the space between the presynaptic and the postsynaptic neuron, and that particular space is known as the synaptic cleft. So the presynaptic neuron releases their neurotransmitter into the synaptic cleft, and when they are in the synaptic cleft, they are going to interact on the receptor present on the postsynaptic neuron, and when they interact, a cellular response that is generated. So in this particular video, I want to focus how these neurotransmitters, they are actually released from these vesicles into the synaptic cleft so that they can interact with the postsynaptic neuron. Now, this is the structure of a neuron. Believe me, this is a neuron. So in the neuron, you have got the cell body. Then you have got the axons. I have a detailed video on the structure of the neuron. So if you have any difficulty in understanding the structure of the neuron, I'll share the link in the description. So you have got the cell body. Then you have got the axons. And these axons, they are actually covered by a particular fatty material, which is known as the myelin sheath. And between the myelin sheath, there are openings. And these openings are known as the node of Ranvier's. And it is these nodes of Ranvier's where actually the exchange of the ion there take place. And hence the message that travels down the axons. At the terminal of the axon, which are known as the axon terminal, there are special channels which are known as the voltage gated calcium channels. So these are calcium channels, but their opening that is dependent on the voltage. They are not dependent on the binding of any ligand. Therefore, we call them as the voltage gated calcium channels. And then you have got the presynaptic membrane, and the presynaptic membrane is actually the end of the neuron where the fusion of the neurotransmitter vesicles they takes place to release the neurotransmitter into the synaptic cleft. So let us discuss this mechanism in detail, how this release actually happens. Now, when you talk about the release of the neurotransmitter into the synaptic cleft, a lot of proteins they are involved. The first class of proteins that we are going to discuss is that proteins which are present on the neurotransmitter vesicles. And those particular proteins which are present on the neurotransmitter vesicles, they are known as the vesicle associated membrane proteins, because they are associated with the vesicles. Therefore, they are known as the vesicle associated membrane proteins. The first and important proteins that are present on the neurotransmitter vesicles, they are known as the synapsin-1 and the synapsin-2. Now, initially, the synapsin-1 and the synapsin-2, they are in the dephosphorylated form. And when the synapsin-1 and synapsin-2, they are in the dephosphorylated form, what they do is, they are actually in interaction with the cytoskeleton, especially the actin filaments. So when the synapsin-1 and synapsin-2 in their dephosphorylated form interact with the actin filament, that means that the neurotransmitter vesicles, they will be struck, and they will be present at a particular place, and they will not be able to move freely. Now, if the neurotransmitter vesicles, they are not in interaction with the cytoskeleton, this means that all of the time they will be fusing with the presynaptic membrane and they will be releasing their neurotransmitter. This is what is not needed. You only want the release of the neurotransmitter when there is a signal, and when there is no signal present, that means you should keep the neurotransmitter vesicles away from the presynaptic membrane, and the synapsin-1 and the synapsin-2 in their dephosphorylated form, they actually interact with the actin filament, thereby keeping these vesicles away from the presynaptic membrane so that they cannot release their neurotransmitters into the synaptic cleft. Another important protein that is present on the neurotransmitter vesicles, they are known as the RAB3A and the RAB3B. And these RAB3A and the RAB3B, they are actually the GTP binding protein. And when you talk about their functions, they actually guide the mobile neurotransmitter vesicles to the active zone where docking occurs. Now, this docking actually is the interaction of the neurotransmitter vesicles with the presynaptic membrane. So that particular mechanism is known as the docking. Because once signal is there, you have released the neurotransmitter vesicles from the actin filament. They should move towards the presynaptic membrane. And the RAB3A and the RAB3B, they are actually guiding the mobile neurotransmitter vesicles to the active zone for docking to be occurred. Another important protein that is present on the presynaptic on the neurotransmitter vesicle, that is known as the synaptobrevin. And when you talk about the function of the synaptobrevin, it is actually involved in recognition of the plasma membrane or recognition of the presynaptic membrane. Another important proteins that are present on the vesicle, on the neurotransmitter vesicle, it is known as the synaptotagmin, and the function of the synaptotagmin is that actually start the process of vesicle fusion. When the neurotransmitter vesicles that come in interaction with the plasma membrane, so this synaptotagmin, it actually start the process of the vesicle fusion. Another important protein is known as the synaptophysin, and this synaptophysin is actually involved in forming a fusion pore with the presynaptic membrane so that the neurotransmitter vesicles that can be released into the synaptic cleft. So what happens is when there is a signal, when there is an action potential, and when there is exchange of the ions at the nodes of a runway, that means you're talking about the opening of the calcium channels. And as I've told you, the calcium channels which are present on the at the exon terminals, they are voltage gated. And when you talk about the action potential, that action potential is actually a voltage. So when the voltage that reaches the exon terminal, that is actually responsible for opening of the calcium channels which are present at the exon terminals. Now, when these calcium channels, they open, that means that the calcium is going to move, the calcium ions, they will move into the exon terminal. The reason is that the concentration of the calcium that is high outside the cell and that is low inside the neuron. So when the calcium channel opens, the calcium is going to move into the neuron because of the concentration gradient. Because the concentration is high outside, it is low inside, so the calcium is going to move into the presynaptic neuron. When the calcium, it enters into the presynaptic neuron, this calcium is going to interact with another protein which is known as the calmodulin protein. So when the calcium that interacts with the calmodulin protein, you are actually going to have a complex of the calcium and calmodulin, and this complex is known as the calcium calmodulin complex. When this calcium calmodulin complex, it is formed, this calcium calmodulin complex is actually responsible for activation of a protein which is known as the CAM kinase 2. So when there is a high concentration of calcium inside the presynaptic neuron that is going to interact with the calmodulin protein, you'd be having the calcium calmodulin complex, and the calcium calmodulin complex is going to activate the KM kinase too. Now what this KM kinase, if you talk about the this KM kinase, this is actually kinase. What this means is that it is going to act on its substrate and it will be adding a phosphate group to it. Because when you talk about the kinase enzymes, kinases are those enzymes which add a phosphate group to its substrate protein. Now when this KM kinase 2, it gets activated, this KM kinase 2 is going to act on the synapsin 1 and the synapsin 2. So you can say that the substrate for the KM kinase 2, that is synapsin 1 and that is synapsin 2. When the KM kinase 2, it phosphorylates synapsin 1 and the synapsin 2, what this means is that the synapsin 1 and 2 is going to move from the dephosphorylated form into the phosphorylated form, because you have added phosphate group to the synapsin 1 and the synapsin 2. Now when the synapsin 1 and 2, they get phosphorylated, in their phosphorylated form, they are not able to interact with the actin filaments. So when they are not able to interact with the actin filaments, that means that the neurotransmitter vesicle that will be released from the actin filaments. And when that is released from the actin filament, that means it is free to move. So when it is free to move, as I've told you, the RAB3A and 3B that will be guiding the mobile neurotransmitter vesicle towards the active zone for a docking to be occurred. Now, when the neurotransmitter vesicle that have been released from the actin filament that have been guided by the RAB3A and the RAB3B towards the presynaptic membrane, the synaptobrevin will then be responsible for recognition of the plasma membrane of the presynaptic neuron. We will talk about this one in a little bit detail, how the synaptobrevin and synaptotagmin that work in coordination with the proteins which are present on the presynaptic membrane for the release of the neurotransmitter. So these are the proteins that are present on the presynaptic membrane. When we talk about the presynaptic membrane, there are also proteins present on the presynaptic membrane. The important protein that are present on the presynaptic membrane, one is known as the syntaxin. And this syntaxin is actually responsible for a recognition of the vesicle membrane or recognition of the neurotransmitter vesicle membrane. What this means is that there is syntaxin present on the presynaptic membrane, the synaptobrevin that is present on the neurotransmitter vesicle. So the syntaxin and the synaptobrevin, they interact with each other so that the neurotransmitter vesicle can interact with the presynaptic membrane. Because if you have got something on the neurotransmitter vesicle which can recognize the presynaptic membrane, you should have something on the presynaptic membrane as well to recognize the membrane of the neurotransmitter vesicle. So the syntaxin is present on the presynaptic membrane, the synaptobrevin is present on the vesicle membrane. So when they interact with each other, that means that the neurotransmitter vesicle will come in interaction with the presynaptic membrane. Another important thing is, as I've told you, there is synaptophysin which is present on the neurotransmitter vesicle, and that is involved in forming a fusion pore with the presynaptic membrane. So where the synaptophysin that actually interacts on the presynaptic membrane. So when you talk about the presynaptic membrane, there is a protein which is known as the physophilin, and the physophilin and the synaptophysin. So this one is from the presynaptic membrane, the synaptophysin is from the neurotransmitter vesicle membrane. So these two, they are actually interacting with each other to make this fusion pore. And when a fusion pore that is formed, you can see, say, if for example, if this is the neurotransmitter vesicle that has interacted with the presynaptic membrane, a particular pore-like structure that will be formed. And during this formation of the pore-like structure, the neurotransmitter which are present in the neurotransmitter vesicle that will be released into the synaptic cleft. And when they are released into the synaptic cleft, they will be able to interact with the receptors which are present on the postsynaptic neuron for generation of a cellular response. So I hope this clarifies how the neurotransmitter vesicles that actually they actually get released into the synaptic cleft. So if I summarize the whole story in like 2 minutes, so the calcium channel, they will open because of the action potential. They will interact with the calcium canmugidine. So the calcium canmugidine complex is going for the activation of the KM kinase 2. The KM kinase 2 is going for the phosphorylation of the synapsin 1 and 2. They will get phosphorylated. They will release the neurotransmitter vesicle from the actin filament. The RAB3A and 3B will guide this moving neurotransmitter vesicle towards the presynaptic membrane. And here the synaptobrevin of the neurotransmitter vesicle and the syntaxin of the presynaptic membrane, they will recognize each other, and then the synaptotagmin will start the process of the vesicle fusion, and the actual vesicle that will be formed by the synaptophysin of the neurotransmitter vesicle and the physophilin of the presynaptic membrane, so that the neurotransmitter, they get released into the synaptic cleft for generation of cellular response. So if you like the video, please subscribe to my channel, hit the like button, and share it with your friends.